We're going to start in Hebrews. Hebrews 13. Let's turn to it if you have your word. Hebrews 13, starting at verse 9. And if you, open your devices, if you don't want to do any of that, I have it on the screen. All right, y'all ready?
Yeah.
Y'all with me? Y'all must be quiet. All right, be good. Here we go. Hebrews 13, 9. And this is the NIV Bible version. It says, "Do not be carried away by all kinds of strange teachings. It is good for our hearts to be strengthened by grace, not by eating ceremonial foods, which is of no benefit to those who do so. We have an altar from which those who minister at the tabernacle have no right to eat. The high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. And so Jesus also suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. Let us then go to him outside the camp, bearing the disgrace he bore. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. And do not forget to do good and share with others, for with such sacrifices God is pleased." Amen. May the Lord bless his holy word. We're going to talk today about a sacrifice of praise. Amen. Someone say a sacrifice of praise. Someone make your declaration. My positive confession, thank you, Sister Lena, is I will give a sacrifice of praise. Someone say that.
I will give a sacrifice of praise.
Okay, so we know we're talking about positive confession month. And how many people are believing for your relationships in your life? Let it be, a friend, a loved one, maybe your spouse, your boyfriend, your boo, your bae. Anybody believe in God? For one of those relationships. In relationships, they're give and take, correct? That's in a proper functional relationship, right? There's this balance of givers and takers, right? And, you can't be too heavy on the taker side, can't be too heavy on the giver side, right? If we were saying, who's the giver in a relationship, everybody would be like, I'm a giver. Nobody wants to be the shady taker, right? But like, raise your hand if you're a taker. Everybody would be like, well, I'm though, not you. But you're probably a bastard person in your life, right? So there has to be some balance. Otherwise, it will be kind of like a black hole. One person may become a black hole of just give all to me, all love, all being, and I'm not giving anything back, right? How many people do not want to be in that relationship? Have been, and I'm currently in it. Don't raise your hand if you're right. Okay. They might be sitting next to me, wink or something. All right. So in a great relationship, there has to be this balance, right? So there's this compromise, and this compromise leads to a sacrifice, correct? You can't just this time we're going to the movies. I'm going to sacrifice going out to eat, right? There has to be some kind of give and take in a relationship, right? Or then it's just this one-sided, selfish situation. So I have a really short story about sacrifice. Someone wrote this story. It's really cute. Many years ago, this person says, when I worked as a volunteer at a hospital, I got to know a little girl named Liz who was suffering from a rare and serious disease. Her only chance of recovery appeared to be a blood transfusion from her five-year-old brother, who had miraculously survived the same disease and had developed the antibodies needed to combat the illness. The doctors explained the situation to her little brother and asked the little boy if he would be willing to give his blood to his sister. I saw him hesitate for a moment before taking a deep breath and saying, "Yes, I'll do it if it will save her." As the transfusion progressed, he lay in the bed next to his sister and smiled, as we all did, seeing the color return to her cheeks. Then his face grew pale and his smile faded. He looked up to the doctor and asked with a trembling voice, "Will I die right away or how soon?" See, the boy had misunderstood the doctor. He thought he would have to give his sister all his blood in order to save her, right? Sacrifice. Before we can really understand what sacrifice of praise is. We need to define sacrifice, all right? Now follow, let's walk through this together. Definition of sacrifice. Sacrifice is a loss or something you give up, usually for the sake of a better cause. For example, parents sacrifice time and sleep. Parents, yes, to take care of children, especially newborns, right? Children might sacrifice TV or maybe a video game time to hang out with your parents, right? And just a side note, sacrifice is usually something that you really like or enjoy, correct? Otherwise, it wouldn't be a sacrifice. You didn't care about it. Oh, sure, take it. All right, I mean, use it, right? Sacrifice is really something that's near and dear to your heart. All right. So, why then would praise be a sacrifice? You ever think about that? Why is praise a sacrifice? Why is it a sacrifice of praise? Why isn't it a blessing of praise, right? Here's a great definition of sacrifice. A sacrifice, to be real, must cost, must hurt, and it must make us empty ourselves. So that's like the real price of a sacrifice, all right? A sacrifice of praise. The term sacrifice and praise seem to be opposite, right? Seem to be two polar opposites. We think of sacrifice as something that costs a great thing to us. Praise, on the other hand, sounds joyful, right? As it bubbles from a grateful heart. However, in the spiritual realm, sacrifice and praise are intertwined. All right, let's unpack what sacrifice meant in the Old Testament so we can understand what sacrifice is. All right, so we're going to Hebrews 13. It says, the high priest carries the blood of animals into the most holy place as a sin offering, but the bodies are burned outside the camp. So going back to the Old Testament so we can unpack it, the first thing you have to recognize, when God laid out all the rules for sacrifices, I don't know if anybody ever ventured into Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, we just kind of skip through that, like what are they talking about, and we keep moving, right? But it's very detailed about sacrifices. And God, in Exodus 34, 20, God had a one rule before we started all this coming into the tabernacle stuff. No one was to show up into my presence empty-handed. No one. Whenever you came to the tabernacle, whenever you came to give offering, whenever we all came together, no one was to come before me empty-handed. God, that's rule number one. That's what God laid out at first. So why did God require sacrifice? Did you ever think about that? You got card-carrying members of PETA in here. You probably don't like this part of the Old Testament. Like, how can they do this to the animals? Like, oh my gosh, that's why I'm a vegetarian or a vegan, right? So why did God, what is all this for? Why sacrifices? So the issue is sin. Somebody say sin.
Sin.
See, God is holy, which means no one can stand before his presence with sin. God is holy. There's nothing impure, anything about him. So sin is like an awful stench in God's nostrils. You know, you guys know awful stench. You ever try to like play off an awful stench, maybe in a conversation or in a room? You just try to go on with life, but the smell is overtaking you. And you're trying, maybe it's a baby diaper, or maybe it's other body part, you know, other things. And you're trying to go on with the conversation, but you just can't seem to. I can't go on, right? Same thing with sin. In God's nostrils, sin is a horrible stench. Because God is just. So we love the great parts of God. God is mercy, but he's also just. Right? So if God is holy and he's just, that means no sin, just because he's holy and no sin can be in his presence. If we're sinful, we can't be in his presence. He's all the way just. He's merciful, but he's just. So, what is the real cost of sin? It's your life. Every sin costs your life. If we really deduce it down and let's really look at it, everybody's sin, the price of your sin is your own life. You sin, then you die. Right? That's why no one can, you know, I've seen an Old Testament, can't look on God and live, or, oh gosh, I seen God and I'll die, right? Because if you see him in your sinful state, you can't handle it. He's God. He's a, he He's amazing, right? So, look how wonderful God is. In order to have fellowship with his people, something or someone had to pay that sin debt. In order to let you live, something had to die to take away the debt that was owed. You get it? Just like if you were driving a car and somebody hit your car and now your car is undrivable, you know, just for that person to be like, ooh, man, that's bad. You know what? I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean it. All right, you good? Sorry. All right. Bye. Thank you. Sorry. My bad. And they go, well, your car still can't drive it. You're still sitting there like, yeah, but somebody got to pay for this car because I can't drive it anymore. Right? Same with sin. My bad, God. Love you. Yeah, but somebody still has to pay for the sin. It's still out there. The account, the balance. Everybody got an overdraft on your, you know, bank account. Wells Fargo don't care if you say sorry. Ooh, I can't. That shit ain't out. I thought I had money. My bad, Wells Fargo. They're like, all right. Your balance is still outstanding until it's what? Come on, y'all. Same with sin. Sin is still out there. It doesn't go into a vacuum or a black hole. It has to be paid for. That's how serious sin is. We think of sin as, oh, it's just a little white lie. Oh my gosh, it's just like, you know. No. Sin is serious, right? So, it's a life for a life. It has to be a life for a life. The theological term is atonement. Atonement means to make amends or repair for a wrong. Repair for a wrong. Biblically, it means to remove a person's guilt. So God ordained animal sacrifices as a sacrifice for sin. Basically, the animal sacrifices its life for the benefit of the person who's bringing a sacrifice. Right? Poor little animals. Yes. If you want you or an animal, you choose. Right? So that's what it was. So the person bringing the sacrifice couldn't bring something he didn't want or couldn't use. He had to bring the best of his flock. And he had to bring it willingly. So out of all your flock, don't go getting a little crippled, little speckled goat on the side that can't hardly run. He's like, here you go, God. No, you had to get that prize, beautiful, without a blemish, your best. You were to give it to God, and you were to do so willingly, right? So, if you look at Leviticus 4, you don't have to do this, but write it down if you're looking at this later. Leviticus 4 gives a whole rundown about sin offerings, all right? Just like it says in the Hebrew, the sin offering. Let's describe what a sin offering was. So, for a sin offering, whenever you sin, Lord, you must bring a bull without defect or spot or blemish, and it must be sacrificed at the tent of meetings. See, that was how the little tabernacle was set up in the wood in the desert, right? That was the tent of meetings. The priest was to lay his hand on a bull as a symbol of transference of guilt. So you bring your sacrifice, they lay their hands on it as a symbol of like, okay, now we're putting your sins on this bull, right? The bull would then be slaughtered. The blood of the animal would be brought into the most holy place. So the bull would be slaughtered, and all this blood would go into the basin, and it would be brought to the most holy place. What is this most holy place? So at the most holy place, there's a curtain right there, and you see that the Ark of the Covenant was in the back. The most holy place was right there. That is a place where the presence of God lived in a tabernacle. A thick veil, see that veil? Separated from the whole other part of the room. No one can enter that particular part except the priest. And that was just once a year to make an atonement for everyone's sin. And even then, he had to go through this whole complicated ritual to purify himself, make sure his self was right before he went in. Or you know what would happen? They would have to put a veil around his ankle as he's walking in there to do the thing, just in case he skipped a step. And all of a sudden you can hear Leroy no more walking around. Hey, and he was to put it on that curtain. See, y'all, you know what I have a problem with these little images. They look so cute and clean. It's like a priest and they look all nice. Everything's so nice. No, we're talking about sacrifices every day for every person. He would have to sprinkle that on blood, on that curtain. So that curtain's a bloody mess by then, right? He was to dip it 7 times, and then certain parts of the bull will be burned on the offering. And after the sacrifice was complete, the remaining items of the bull, his body, will be taken outside the camp and burned. Right, you guys got the whole process? Now, that's just not like for one little nice person. That was for the whole, that's for everybody. So basically, the priest, it was like a glorified butcher shop. That was their job. They were coming in, they were doing sacrifice, and it wasn't like, oh, cute little, I'm just gonna poke you and kill you. No, it was slit their neck. It was a mess, right? They don't show that in all pictures, and I'm gonna show you these, and I didn't want to freak you guys out. All right, so let's try to keep it real up in here. All right, so let's talk about we're gonna go forward about outside the camp. We gotta deal with this outside the camp. You guys learning something? You guys with me? All right, outside the camp. It's in this verse. It says, burned outside the camp. It said, Jesus also suffered outside the city at the gate to make his people holy through his own blood. Outside the camp was a crazy place. It was a place where all the unceremonial, clean people lived. It would be like our modern-day dump, city dump, our landfill, or our sewer. So if you were to go through all those tedious books of the Bible, I mean, God has given you every detail. You must do this, you can't touch that, you can't eat that, you can't do this. And if you violate any of those things, well, outside the camp. Y'all go out there for like 7 days. We'll see you in a week. All right. So anybody who went outside the camp, it was for people who had skin diseases like lepers, because they were contagious. They had to go outside the camp. Right? Dead bodies would be burned there. Or even if you accidentally touched a dead body or a dead animal, outside camp, see ya, right? Come back in 3 days. Women who were menstruating, that's called hundlings. Outside camp, see ya in 7 days. All your, you know, all the products and things you have to use, that went outside camp. Anything bloody, mildew, dirty, household items, if you had like a plague breakout in your house or something, outside camp, right? Nobody wanted to be outside camp. It was like terrible. It was like living in a city dump. But outside camp was a place of defilement, uncleanliness, impurity, corruption, dirtiness, filthiness, pollution, contamination, punishment, rejection, reproach. It is where sin, it is where disease, dung, death, they were everywhere. Anyone who was banished to the outside of the camp was excluded, isolated, and ostracized. Yet, in this Hebrew passage, it says that Jesus was taken outside the camp. It says that Jesus suffered shame and reproach. How can this be? Does not the Old Testament demand that only those who are unclean, leprous, defiled, blasphemers, people who are worthy of death, people who have committed capital crimes, go outside the camp? But Hebrews 13:12 says, Jesus suffered outside the gate. He was tortured and executed by crucifixion in a place where all the criminals and all who had committed capital offenses were tortured and executed. Not inside the camp or the city, but outside the camp. They wouldn't dare crucify someone in the confines of the city. Jesus was taken outside the camp to a place called Golgotha, meaning of a skull, a place of death. Criminals were put there. These scum of the earth, lowlifes, were mocked, tortured, and killed. So putting this all in perspective of sacrifice, Jesus was taken outside of the camp. He was disgraced. He was a bloody mess. Anyone seen the Passion of the Christ? Only a fraction of that really shows what Jesus went through. He was beaten to a bloody pulp. He was beyond recognition. When he was on the cross, you couldn't even tell really if it was a human. What is that up there? He was whipped and beat, blood everywhere. All right? Just like the bulls, remember the sacrifices and the bulls and all that? Blood everywhere. And it's just a, don't look at the nice little pictures they have. It was a bloody mess, right? And that curtain, remember the curtain that was sprinkled? Guess what? When Jesus died, that curtain was torn in two by God. So now remember the access of that, the holies of holies that separated man and separated, you can't go in there, but not go in there. Guess what? When Jesus gave his life and his blood, that tore, that curtain was torn from top to bottom. You see, if you tear things, you tear from bottom to top. That tore, that curtain was torn from top to bottom. God tore that veil, saying that now you have access. Now we have access. You don't need a blood of a bull. You don't have to kill no more animals. Jesus' blood was the sole sacrifice and the atonement, the payment. Remember the payment plan we was on? It wasn't working. That payment plan that you needed to get access to God has now been fulfilled. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad for Jesus? Come on, somebody let do it though. Aren't you glad about Jesus? Poor little animal, what if you got a one animal here today? If you had to do a sacrifice every day for everybody, Lord Jesus, poor little animals. So aren't you glad that he paid the price? Now, this is the catch. We're still talking about sacrifice of praise. We are not to forget his sacrifice. We are to go outside the camp with him. Going outside is a constant reminder, remembering the price Jesus paid for us. We tend to feel like, you know what, Jesus paid it all and I have no more responsibilities. He paid it all. I don't have to do nothing. I'm just going to come to church, I'm going to put my little time in, take it off my list, go home, watch football like he did. Right? Jesus already paid it all. I don't have to do much. But he did pay it all for your salvation, but you still have a responsibility in your relationship to him. Your salvation is paid for, but then we still have a relationship to fulfill, right? The old song says, must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? Is he the only one to bear the reproach? Is Jesus the only one to take all the beatings and the punishment, and we're just supposed to skip off and go free? Thank Jesus, bye! Or we're to continually go to that outside of that camp, that disgraceful place, and be like, oh my God, thank you, Jesus. We come here, we barely have a praise, we barely can say anything, we barely clap, we need to have a reminder. Go outside the camp. Look at Jesus. You know, we're not like, we don't believe in, you know, still holding Jesus on the cross and, you know, having all these images of him. But sometimes in your mind, you do need to remember what he did for you, right? He paid the price. But what has it cost you to follow Jesus lately? He paid the cost. But what has it cost you anything to follow Jesus lately? Remember Exodus 34 and 20, I said that it said that no one comes to God empty-handed. That still rings true. Still, no one is to come before God empty-handed. But we make money, and I have my dollar ready. No, that's not what he's talking about. Still, no one comes into his presence empty-handed. Now, all God requires is a sacrifice of praise. The fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. That's all he requires for us. A sacrifice of praise. So in light of this, we get to Hebrews 13:15. Through Jesus, therefore, let us continually offer to God a sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that openly profess his name. Let's break this down a little further so we can see, how do we offer the sacrifice of praise? What does it mean? Okay, I understand the Old Testament meaning. What does this mean today? Okay, the first thing we have to look at is through Jesus. Somebody say, through Jesus. It's through Jesus. We cannot offer to God the best we have apart from the blood that Jesus shed on the cross. His sacrifice makes our sacrifice of praise acceptable, right? We must come to the Father by him. Though we have a responsibility to worship the Father, we cannot come to him on our own merit, our own basis. We only have access to his presence through the blood of Jesus. Not only that, but Jesus' sacrifice should be the fuel for our worship. We should offer him the best we have because he offered us the best he had. fuel is His blood. Remember, our blood can do it. We can get to God. We would die in His presence. So guess what? Every time God sees you, you think He sees cute little you? You are wonderful and you're fearfully made in His sight. But He doesn't see you. What does He see on you? The blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. So when He looks at you, the only thing that makes you acceptable to come into His presence is the blood of Jesus that He spilled outside of the camp. No longer do we need the blood of animals. It's His blood. So it's through Jesus. You got to get this. So there's nothing you can do to get to Jesus, to get to God, on your own. We can run laps. We can go walk old ladies across the street all day. We can feed the hungry. We can fight the power all day. But it won't make us worthy to stand into His presence. It's the blood of Jesus. How many are thankful for the blood of Jesus? So the sacrifice of praise is nothing that you can do on your own. It's through Jesus. Amen. It's through Jesus that we offer the sacrifice of praise. I'm so glad for Jesus. So glad for Jesus. The next thing, so we went through Him. It says, let us continually. Let us continually. It says that a sacrifice of praise is to be offered continually. Our praise of God is not to be based on our opinion of His job performance. Right? Praise cannot be treated as a reward we give to God for His obvious blessings. I guess I'm just going to go in here and say thank you, Lord, because You've been good. Never could have made it. Yes, Lord. All right. I'm done. No, it can't just be based on your opinion of who God is. Real praise continues regardless of circumstances. It goes from a place and a heart of worship that worships it in good times and in bad times, and not just on Sundays. A continually offering God a praise. Continually. Right? Psalm 34:1 says, I will bless the Lord when? At all times. His praise shall what? Continually be in my mouth. In 1 Chronicles 23:30, it was the responsibility of the Levitical priest to stand every morning and thank and praise the Lord. And then every evening, they were to do the same. It was a mandate. Before y'all get up, y'all say thanks to God. We'll go this for the whole camp. Y'all give thanks in the morning and the evening. But guess what? We are priests now. Did you know that? Tell your neighbor, say, I'm a priest. You didn't even know I was a priest. Right? 1 Peter 2:9 says, you are a chosen generation. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, His own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Him who calls you out of darkness into His marvelous light. So guess what? You just took over their job in the Old Testament. You are a priest now. You don't have to wait for them to give sacrifices to you. You give it to Him day and night, in season and out of season, good, bad, indifferent, right? Continually. Someone say continually. Continually. That doesn't mean that you're the spooky person that's just always, well, God, praise God, I'm blessed, highly favored. You're always having a catchphrase. We're not talking about being disingenuous. We're talking about having a real praise that flows from your heart. Continually. You're offering it to God. Right? Which brings us to our next point. Through Jesus, let us continually offer to God. Offer to God. I want my praise to far exceed any other thing that I praise. Right? So if anybody knows me, you know that I'm a big sports fan, right? I'm an athletic director at the high school just down the street. I love sports. I love my 49ers. Y'all pray our strength on today. Pray our strength. We go against the evil. Over on this side. Big sports fan. If games, right? But I refuse to offer more praise to the 49ers or the Warriors or my baby graduation or my kid and they little football games. I won't give them more praise than I'm going to give God, all right? A sacrifice of praise. Did you know that praise doesn't always cost you anything? Think about it. Praise doesn't always cost you anything. Jack Hamper wrote, "We praise our dogs for fetching a ball. We praise people for a job well done. Praise is often a response to some reaction or action that directly benefits us. We feel generous because we extend it. We often find it easy to praise God from that same motivation. When He has blessed us, helped us, protected us, praise flows from a generous place, right? Oh, Jesus, thank you. Had a good week. Had a promotion. Thank you, God, right? We can sing, worship, and talk about how good He is because we can see it. We can see everything God is doing, right? That's what we in here jumping and praising. That kind of praise, although worthwhile, does not cost us anything. It's not a sacrifice. It's bubbling up from a good place. You're in a good mood. Your kids didn't get on your nerves this morning before you got to church. Bless God. Nobody called me down on earth. You didn't even, I'm on my way to church. Leave me alone with all that, right? Nobody meant. So you feel good. You're praising God. Right? That kind of praise doesn't always cost you anything. But then there are those times when God does not come through in the way we thought He would. The medical test comes back positive. Someone you love dies. Your spouse wants a divorce. Your child is wayward. Your job lays you off. You might be getting evicted. God seems very far away. And praise is the last thing that bubble up from our hearts. We can't see His goodness, and the circumstances scream that He has forgotten us. Yes, I feel God all over this. To praise God in those times requires a personal sacrifice. Amen. The word sacrifice comes from the root of meaning to kill or slaughter for a purpose. Praise often requires that we kill our pride. sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies a living sacrifice. Holy and pleasing to God, this is your true and proper worship. A living sacrifice. My God, it's a killing of our flesh, a laying down of our will. Remember the rules of sacrifice, something must die. Remember? Something's got to die for it to be a sacrifice. Life. Same rules apply. So there's a laying down of our flesh and our will. Our will. Somebody say our will. See, God is so awesome because he's given each one of us human beings a thing called free will. Which is amazing because he's God. And if he wanted to, he could have just created a bunch of robots who would have been like, we love Jesus, we love Jesus, we love Jesus, yes Lord, yes Lord. But he didn't want that. He wanted us to choose him. You can have all these options, but you want him. That's free will. That's what happened in the garden. You ever wonder why he, why Lord, why you put that one little tree? For them to choose to obey him, choose to love him. Same with our lives. You got all these crazy situations going on, right? Anybody got craziness? I'm the only one. All right, I got one witness. Crazy stuff. Like, what is this? But is it a situation for you to choose him, to lay your will down as a living sacrifice? And give your will to him. Right? When this takes an act of the will to lay our all on an altar before God, even when we don't understand. When we bring a sacrifice of praise, we choose to believe that even though life is not going the way we think it should, God is still good and he's still to be trusted. When we choose to praise God in spite of the storms, he is honored and our faith grows deeper. Earlier, remember we said sacrifice must be real. In order to be real, it must cost, it must hurt, and you must empty yourself. When was the last time your worship equaled this definition? That it cost you, it hurt, and you had to really empty yourself to do it. So we got some hard situations in here. You're thinking of some things that are tough right now. And our first reaction is to be like, man, forget it, I give up, right? But God wants you to choose to trust him and worship him in spite of. That is a sacrifice of praise. In 2 Samuel 24, we read earlier, David had really messed up, like big time. God told him not to count people, his armies, because I just want you to believe that when you go out to battle, I got you. You don't have to count no army. You're not supposed to be like, we got 50,000 people, and we gonna whoop y'all, right? It's like, no, don't even count them. When I call for war, y'all just go. No, they're not with you. David messed up. He counted them anyway, right? So then God brought a plague on the land. So in order to stop the plague, they was like, man, I gotta give up the sacrifice to God to show how sorry I am, right? So the guy who he went to go buy the sacrifice was like, here, David, oh my gosh, the king is here. I can't believe it. Here, take our oxen, take the goat, take the threshing floor, take anything you need, David. Go give your sacrifice. But David said to him, no, I insist on paying you for it. I will not sacrifice to the Lord my burnt offerings that don't cost me anything. I will not sacrifice anything to God that doesn't cost me nothing. Right? What has worship or praising God cost you? What would be the hardest thing to praise God for right now? Think about it. Is it that regret, that heartache, that disappointment? that loved one had died. You know, holidays are hard for a lot of us who have lost our loved ones along the way. It's a hard time sometimes. What about that disappointment that you're on strike with God about, right? Worship doesn't depend on how the worshiper feels, but how great a God that he is worshiping. Worship doesn't depend on outer appearance of the worshiper or of his circumstances, but on the greatness of the one who controls the circumstance and the work that he has done inside of the worshiper. Right? That's the sacrifice of praise. Giving God, it's not a favor, just like, oh, I'm just going to thank you, God, for this that's going on. Like, I'm laying down my will, God. And people are looking at you like, how can you praise God right now? You see what's going on here? Are you serious? Like, you should be mad. You should be ready to fight. We should be going to war. And like, no, I'm going to offer to God a sacrifice. It costs me. It's going to cost me to say thank you, Lord, for this. Because I don't feel like saying that, and I'm mad about it. I don't understand it. But I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to put it on the altar and say, God, you take it. It's a sacrifice of praise. Thank you, Jesus. It says the fruit of lips. This speaks of first fruits. The best, first pick, ready to eat, not left over. They also had a first fruits offering. They had so many offerings in the Old Testament. There was a first fruit offering that you gave God, the first that you had, the best that you had, right? Remember, the worship didn't bring something he couldn't want, that he didn't want or couldn't use. He had to bring the best of his flock. He had to be willing to do it. And the requirement is still true of worshipers today. You must bring the best you have, not your leftovers, and bring it willingly. So, what's usually on your lips, right, from day to day? What is the fruit of your lips from day to day? Are you a complainer? Are you a grumbler? Are you a critic? Are you negative? You know, don't give God the last fruits from your lips. After you done talk about it all to your family, your cousin and them, you know, put it on Instagram, you know, Facebooked it, and it's like, oh yeah, I guess I'm gonna talk to God now. Right? He wants the best, he wants the first, he wants you to give it willingly. The fruit of your lips. What are you saying? What are you confessing? The fruit of your lips, what are coming out of your lips? What are you known for? If someone was to categorize you, what would they categorize the fruit of your lips saying? What are you saying all day? What would your coworkers say that you say mostly all day? Your classmates, your teammates. What is the fruit of your lips? This is where your positive confession comes in. The more powerful, what more powerful is to confess the word of God or to worship him? What else can we say that's that even more? We can say, Lord, I thank you for a car, thank you for all these things are great. But what's even greater than to always confess his word? Always worship in his name. Now, you know there's power in your worship? That's why the Satan works so hard to cut your worship off. He's trying to silence your tongue. He's trying to silence your lips. He wants to duct tape over you because he knows there is power in your worship. Death and life is in the power of your tongue. Remember the story in the Old Testament, in Chronicles, before they went out to defeat this army. This army was coming to whoop them. They were like, we coming to get y'all. And they was like, oh, Lord, they were scared. They didn't know what to do. God said to go send the worshipers out in front of them. Can you imagine sending the worshipers in front of an army? They're not like putting our praise team up there before they even going out to Iran. Y'all go first. Go ahead. Go on out there, praise team. And we'll be back behind y'all with guns and spears. Right? That's amazing. To put the praise team first in front of the army. And they just say, you give thanks to the Lord, because love endures forever. And when they got to the army, they got to the campsite, the whole army had already been annihilated. He had already took God and already fought the battle for them. That's why he wants to praise you, silence your tongue. That's why you got to worship God all the more. It's a sacrifice of praise. You got to worship him all the more. When you feel like, I ain't going to do it. by telling others of the glory of his name, to acknowledge his name, right? Openly professing his name. Psalms 54:6 says, I will freely sacrifice to you. I will praise your name, O Lord, for you are good. Giving thanks to his name is simply the making of a confession. It is agreeing with God about who he is and acknowledging his authority and his character. Worshiping his name. The Greek word means homologo. Literally means to speak the same thing. Right? It could be translated as profess or confess. So we are to speak the same thing that the Bible says about Jesus' name, right? We're to speak the same thing the Bible says. Speak the same things about. Do you know there's power in the name of Jesus? There is really power in the name of Jesus. If you ever get in a tight spot in a situation, you call in the name of Jesus. There is power. All power in heaven and earth is given to Jesus. So there's power in his name. So you got to speak the same thing about who Jesus is. Do you really know who he is? Do you know how much power is in his name? Just the name of Jesus. He is an advocate. He is the Almighty. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the atoning sacrifice of our sin. I'm talking about the name of Jesus. He is the author of life, the author and the perfecter of our faith. He is the beginning and the end, the bread of life, the creator, the deliverer, our everlasting Father. He is the gate. He is faithful and true. He is a faithful witness. He is the first and the last. He is the firstborn from the dead. How many are glad for Jesus? From you. He don't make you guess, like, I wonder what pleases God. He said it very clearly. pleases God. To do good and to share with others. So, in summing up, if you let God's praise continually be on your lips, if you are loving and praising and blessing and worshiping God, if you are doing good to others, then you are obeying the first and second commands to love God and love your neighbors as yourself. This is how you live a life as a sacrifice of praise. We live our lives as sacrifices of praise to God when we do good to others. We do good to others. We can't just have it in these four walls. And we can't just wait for the church to have, put something on. I'm waiting for an outreach. When we hand it out turkeys. We can't just wait for that. There's people in your influence of life that you can be doing good for right now. Message Rock says, make sure you don't take things for granted and go slacking and working for the common good. Share what you have with others. God takes particular pleasures in acts of worship, a different kind of sacrifice that takes place in the kitchen and the workplace and on the streets. That's your act of worship. That's your sacrifice of praise. Who can you bless this week? Not just the homeless people that who can you share with this week in your life? Who can you do good to? At this time, we're going to have a time of prayer where we're able to respond to the message on today. We talked about several things, but the main thing I want so much is for Jesus to be glorified and for us to appreciate the wonderful sacrifice that he did on a cross for our sins through his blood. Our blood could do it. The blood of animals couldn't do it. It was his blood that has saved us and redeemed us. And that becomes your fuel of worship. You're living a life of worship. You don't just worship when you get into this house. You worship